Welcome everyone to Writing Nights Press Take the Night Off Inspiration Showcase. I am Azriel Johnson, your host for this evening. We have three amazing poets tonight. Before we bring those poets up, I'd like to ask you three questions. The best place to write is?
Here.
The best person to write is?
You.
The best time to write is?
Now.
Thank you. We'll get better at this over the night. Just for people on the internet who will see this later, and for people here, we have shirts available. $7 because you paid admission, trying to get the Writing Nights out there. We got the words on the back, only poetry can save you now. Red, blue, black. If we don't have your size, we have more shirts at a different location. So just let me know if you want to get one. Also, we have books behind there. Two of them are for John. I haven't published Derek or Alicia yet, unfortunately, so we'll get there someday. It'll happen someday. Submissions open November.
You better.
All right, anyway, without further ado, let's bring up our first poet. Bringing you urban poetry at its best, please welcome Derek Terrell.
By holding up.
Holding up,
scroll. I'm supposed to have another book out by today, but life happened. My laptop picked up. So I'll be reading from the other three that I have. From Candle High, homegrown right here.
All right.
Let's get the go here. First one. I wrote this. I really don't have a line up for what I do. I just fan through and see which one fits best. So let's see here. My Summer Love, 2013. I wrote this one. I was actually writing a second book. I hit the wall, you know, writer's wall. So I went down to Florida, you know, to try to get it up off me. Wrote this down. A few of my colleagues defected from Canton, Ohio. They gave me reports of her. These swell tales set my mind adrift, so I blueprinted plans for a quest to obtain. You see, me being an Aquarius gave me a sign that we were destined. I joined a caravan that channeled straight to her. 12 hours later, we had the custom of our encounter. With grit rock at my feet, I stood in silence. Passed up by her beauty, hypnotized by her way. But it was high noon and I was forced to share. Mentally, I devised a scheme for a moonlit rendezvous. So upon nightfall, I returned with an MP3 player that wore On the Ocean by K. John, you know, to set the order. A little reflection off her had me reflecting on the stress that comes with being a Cantonian and how being her presence and all. I removed certain linens, preparing to enter her. The warmth of her wetness had me sinking more and more in love with her. Aquariuses are known for their spontaneity, so instantly I let her walk her tide, whirlpool me into a passionate state of tranquility, felicity, submerging, engulfing me. And for the umpteenth time, I had fallen in love. The first and last name, Atlantic Ocean. Mm.
Feel free to speak a little louder.
Okay.
Yeah, you're not going to deafen us.
This one is a stalker's thoughts that turn into action. I was watching the the ID station 24 hours, 7 days a week, and so I wrote this one. I will not allow these raindrops nor the cops to stop me from patiently waiting for you in front of your spot. You see, I knew that when we first met and you were jogging around your block, that for me to get adjacent with you, I'd have to draw up some scheme or some plot. So early the next day, without invading your personal space, I quietly pursued you and we ended up in a Winn-Dixie parking lot. And I can see it just like it was yesterday. We finished up at the same time, went through the same cashier, and for a hot second, your eyes met up with mine. My flashback is interrupted by headlights, so I squat, because I will not allow these raindrops, nor the cops, to stop me from patiently waiting for you in front of your spot. After enjoying the view of watching you shop, now I'm not the type to eavesdrop, but since I was in your neighborhood, I posted outside your window like a prop. And finally, there you stand within the confines of your window pane, glance in my direction, and remove your top. During my self-satisfaction, I had a faint and a flop. But once again, my flashback is interrupted by headlights, so I squat, because I will not allow these raindrops, nor the cops, to stop me from patiently waiting for you in front of your spot. It was from that moment that I knew that I fell in love with the cream of the crop. Something about the way your frame framed your windows, your silhouette with low watts, that led me to do what some call Facebook stalk. Your cell number was on there, but understand, I meant no harm when I called and hung up as soon as you answered the phone at 4 o'clock. But baby, I just wanted to hear your voice, and since it was so early, I figured out you didn't want to talk. Yes, it's me that keeps calling private, but when you pick up, I can't figure out some clever line to concoct. Hold on. I called once again, and I got your robot. Maybe I should have called on block. Then my thought is interrupted by headlights, so I squat, because I will not allow these raindrops, nor the cops, to stop me from patiently waiting for you in front of your spot. This morning I missed you so much that I followed you, and now you're caught. That little brunch date you had with that buff dude in the BMW, the license plate, the red sky, has my temperature heated way past hot. You were sitting too close to him with your hand on his legs, and your legs was crossed. With your right hand way too close to his cock. I can't stand this. Thank God that this thought is interrupted by headlights, so I squat and grab my composure, because I will not allow these raindrops nor the cops to stop me from patiently waiting for you in front of your spot. Duct tape, rope, a banana block. This is where you've taken us, so this is what I've got. And as soon as I wait, slow headlights, don't be a W in the stop. A little freaky one, wasn't it? Okay. Let's see here. Let me read from this one. This is my second book, titled Me Being True to Myself Culture. There's something in here. All right, maybe one more try. That's the name of this one. I've turned away when I should have stood my ground. I've gotten physical when I should have been verbal. I've stood my ground when I should have turned away. I should have been verbal when I should have gotten physical. I was a giver when I should have been a taker. I've loved when I should have hated. I was a taker when I should have been a giver. I hated when I should have loved. I've cried when I should have laughed. I've been alone when I should have been in the crowd. I've laughed when I should have cried. I've been in the crowd when I should have been alone. I've told the truth when I should have lied. I've walked when I should have ran. I've lied when I should have told the truth. And I've ran when I should have walked. I've sang when I should have danced, and I've danced when I should have sang. I've also given up when I shouldn't. But that's how I know how to get it right. So now I'm asking, maybe just one more try. Suicide by sentiment. A good friend of mine had been murdered by her boyfriend. Let's give my deliberations and emotions an alignment for the acknowledgement or suggestion of suicide by sentiments. You see, a menacing love had her in bondage. Confusion stationed her in a mind frame of wonderment. Motherly clairvoyance scouted her for tranquility and security. She remained confined by punishment, as if love should come equipped with an escape compartment. If I ever go back to him, I know he'll kill me, was her multiple renounced law. Morning, close acquaintances, return to disagreements. There was a return to this imprisonment, which led to her bereavement. That conducts us to disacknowledgement or suggestion. If one can end their existence by police department, one commits suicide by sentence. Alright, let me try one for my first book, Renaissance Poetry. I'll probably get back. Let's see what we got here. To the third book. Go back to Third Eye Drops, my third book. Minimum wage slave. If employment petitions are the auction blocks for swindled prisoners nowadays, that makes managers with masters likely to practice the whips on the back of us minimum wage slaves. Sharecroppers were permitted to use the land but had to cut the owner in on what was made. There's a certain working class that child support, the state, the city, Uncle Sam, deducts the citizens before they even get their pay. Now I'm not condoning it, but I can see why some, in the eyes of the law, misbehave. Yet they're taught to think that drugs are a plague. My third eye is open as I've come of age. Against the machine we all should live. Why? For we all are minimum wage slaves. Poverty isn't a situation, it's an injustice. If you still don't see that, you should be enraged. While panhandlers average about 100 a day, you can obtain an occupation and still barely survive pay to pay. We really don't see the hour of the government's ways. We need a new Louis P. Newton standing in the old Capitol steps with a 12 gauge. But who of us is sick enough of this charade, sick enough to stand up for the minimum wage slave? All right. Pick this before you pick six. Do you picture this when you pick six? Boob jobs, ass, tits, season tickets to your favorite ball club, Land Rovers, Jags, old school whips, pimped out rides, multi-million dollar homes, franchise food joints, tailor-made clothes, paid-off debts. Almost none of us picture this when we pick six. Addiction, lawsuits, quick 15 minutes, death, bankruptcy. Some good Samaritans picture this when they pick six. Giving back to the community, a large offering, aid to the homeless, gratuity to a waitress. Just once picture this when we pick six. How much does the lottery take in? Where does it go? Let's take, for example, this state, Ohio. 30% will go to education. That percentage will be divvied up between 615 different school districts, breaking down less than 4% each district. Stark County School District has 22 schools in it. The add.8 should be null and void, but you gotta picture this when you pick six. Poverty is an injustice. A succession of humans form outside the entrance of the soup kitchen. For some, humility is being established. Layoff letterheads face a proportion of the construed multitude. Pride is a bitter taste. Not all the patron of food pantry are vagabonds. Individuals with college education rummage through breads and canned goods. Clothing being dangled from extended extensions while being assessed for laddies and lasses. 46 million live in need and hardship while grossing 22K or less annually. 7 million labors moonlight. The culture between rich and poor is widening. Armed soldiers are returning from tours to squat in sensual foreclosing properties. Unlawful acts materialized that were GPS wanting to imprison me. Administration makes provision, but only to a certain gist. The regiment releases food stamps, but that's barely sufficient. Jilting 1 out of 4 children, starving during arithmetic, abdomen cavities rumble during grammar. Poverty isn't a situation, it's an injustice. A one-night stand postponed. The wrath brought her from over yonder. Indifferently, I come across as a jerk or as a jack. The chance I should play the fool, the jester, or maybe the ninny. Truth. Oh, I just want to get this drunken merry maiden into my humble abode. Ice picking for conversation, I inquire, how art thou? Here I come across if she has obtained a bow yet. Tonight, that answer does not pertain to me. As the maiden and I adjourn to another part of the pub, you have plans after the final summon, I pray, I say. Because all I want is to get this drunken merry maiden into my humble abode. The maiden responds in agreement. Attempting not to be the lozzle that I am, we exit out the back without paying the bill. Hark, I'm balling on the budget. To depart, we arrive at our steed. We saddle up and she plays still red. The destination is conquered. Alas, I have this drunken merry maiden in my humble abode. I present her with a box of crushed grapes as libation. As she sits twisted, for she informs me that she likes to smoke. To get in her feeling relaxed and hope together, I'm mostly Teddy P. The drunken maiden and myself adventure to my bedchamber. Prophylactics are brandished because I am not baseless. The drunken maiden cautiously undressing after she lies upon the bed. I submerge underneath the linens to give her nothing of taste. Next, I arise with a furious anger, throwing the covers off. Because after finally getting this drunken maiden to my humble abode, a twat I plot.
Five minutes.
All right, this one's called Morris Loan. He came from the PJ, so he's used to having not broke. His pops and mom, Dukes, lived off the system, so he's used to never having a lot. So he took the books with the expectation that school would give his hope, his life hope in a different look. It's either that or cook some coke with baking soda and become a crack cook. Nope. House parties, he's like, I got a pass, I have ambitions, graduating top of my class. Oh. He did walk across the stage valedictorian into Morehouse. Growth. With a degree in business administration, he purchased his dream automobile and moved from his dorm to a mansion house, chateau. Feeling that he's willing to share his new existence, becomes a model's boyfriend. Above, blueprints of a happily ever after matrimony are proposed when she moves in. Yo, the MMI that he's employed at closes. Then he takes to the henny, he takes to the gin. Next they take to the weed, molly, cocaine, ecstasy, and heroin, making them lose focus on their moment of sin. Whoa. Just a few years removed from the Mr. and Mrs. Mansion, he's living in Highland Park. He hoards items from his past like Noah did the art, animals in his art. Though, he still has use for his tools, his trophy, his guitar, his watch, his rings, his necklace, his GPS, his iPod, his iPad, his printer, his laptop, his digital computer, his cell phone, his Xbox, his PlayStation. He walks into Morris Loans and says, I just sold my radio. I just sold my television. Thank you.